This video is sponsored by the Great Courses Plus. Doing biology work is a lot like cooking. You're always following a recipe, but there are countless potential tweaks and variations you can make to change the final outcome. With biology, every technique has half a dozen variations, and the ingredients are made by dozens of manufacturers, each with their own custom blends of compounds for the task at hand. Think of biological reagents like barbecue sauce. A recipe may just call for barbecue sauce, but there are dozens of brands and flavors, and your choice can play a big role in how the final dish tastes. So most lab work requires some knowledge of which protocol variations and particular products work for your specific experiment. Take electrophoresis, for example. Using the same basic recipe, you can perform all of these different blotting experiments on a huge assortment of molecules. Or with PCR, there's likely dozens of different types based on the DNA source and what you're trying to do to it, as well as a ton of other subtle factors. What usually ends up happening is you shop around, look at all the different products and protocols, and see if you can find one that says it does the thing you're trying to do. Then you order those supplies, try it out, and see what happens. Maybe it works right off the bat, but often you'll end up having to try a couple others before you find one that gives you good results. Today we're going to look at one central recipe and some of the variations we've been using over the past few months. If you've been following along, you'll know that we're working on engineering a strain of yeast to produce spider silk. One of the first steps in that process is getting some DNA out of the spiders so we can isolate the silk gene itself. This has proven to be a nightmare, and to date I've used almost a dozen spiders in various attempts. So today we're going to explore and compare successful DNA extraction procedures for two different DNA sources, some bacteria and the spiders. Before we go further, let's go over the basic cake recipe before we talk about flavors. We'll be using a column-based approach, which tends to give better results than the shot glass and alcohol method you may have seen before. It's not to say that that can't work, but this method is more gentle and keeps the DNA intact better, as well as being standard lab procedure. There are also other variations like bead-based methods, and we'll look at some of those in future videos. All of these extractions work on a similar series of steps. First, we get the thing we want to extract DNA from, and then make it into a sort of paste and add a salty, soapy solution to it. This pops open all the cells so the DNA is floating around in the salty water. We then remove as much of the debris as we can, be it bits of broken cells, or a leg, or whatever else. This is done using a centrifuge, and all the heavy debris will sink to the bottom. We then take our clean solution and load it into this special tube. It's basically the world's smallest coffee filter, and the filter in this case is either made of silica or a special resin. We load the tube into a larger tube, which will act as our collection cup, and then spin it in the centrifuge to pull the liquid through the filter. DNA is negatively charged, and in the salty conditions of the solution, the silica or resin becomes positively charged, so the two stick together. When we spin down the column, the rest of the solution containing everything else just passes right through. We then do a series of washes to clean everything, and then we're ready to collect the DNA. We transfer the filter to a clean tube, and then add a small amount of either sterile distilled water or various other solutions, so long as they're not salty. Without the salt, the silica's charges get hidden and the DNA falls off. This time, when we spin everything down, we end up with a tiny amount of concentrated DNA solution. Most of the time when you do this, you buy the tubes as a kit that come with all the different solutions you'll need. The manufacturers tune the solutions in each kit to work for their particular application, so if you try and mix and match, your results can be pretty poor. Right now I have two different kits, and I even tried mixing up my own solutions, though that didn't work very well. Let's start with the bacterial kit. This one is made to isolate plasmids, which are small circles of DNA that we add to bacteria to make them do new things, sort of like putting a CD into a computer. In this case, I grew some E. coli that have a plasmid in them that makes them bioluminesce, but this should work regardless of what the exact plasmid is. The plasmid uses tetracycline as the selection agent, so I prepared 1 milliliter of LB broth with 10 micrograms per milliliter of tetracycline and inoculated it with some bacteria and let it grow overnight. On the day of the extraction, I first spun down this liquid to collect all the bacteria into a little pellet at the bottom. The LB was removed, and then it was onto the various buffers and solutions in the kit. The kit just labels things like PD1, PD2, and W1, which doesn't really tell you what's going on, but I was able to find some more info online. PD1 contains an enzyme called RNAs, which, as the name implies, destroys RNA. This is to make sure you only isolate DNA. PD2 is what's called a lysis buffer. Basically, it's very salty and contains a special soap or surfactant, in this case SDS, as well as an enzyme called lysozyme, which eats bacterial cell walls. The salt makes the bacteria shrink, the enzyme eats away at the structural integrity of the bacteria, and since cells are basically living bubbles of oil, the soap makes them all pop open, and whatever was contained inside is released into the solution. You add both of these to your bacterial pellet, and then resuspend the bacteria and let it sit for a few minutes so it has some time to work. Once it's done, we add PD3, which seems to crash out all the proteins and debris from the solution, making it go cloudy. We spin this down, which collects all the floating junk at the bottom, leaving our DNA in solution. Then we carefully pipette off the upper liquid, called the supernatant, and run it through the filter using the centrifuge. After it's been run through the column, we wash the filter with wash buffer, which contains a large amount of alcohol to help remove any stubborn organics. We then spin the filter while it's empty for a few minutes to dry it so all the ethanol is gone before we elute the DNA. For the elution, we add 50 microliters of sterile water or elution buffer since the kit comes with that. Rather than spinning it down immediately, we wait 5 to 10 minutes to give the DNA time to release from the filter. I've left columns for half an hour or more if I really want the DNA to come off. Then we spin it down to collect our sample. You can actually run a second batch of elution buffer through or collect the first batch and run it through again to try and squeeze out every last bit of DNA. But that's it, and the extraction is complete. It's pretty slow because of all the waiting for things to spin, but it can be done in less than an hour once you get a rhythm going. As I mentioned earlier, there are some other variants of this same basic protocol, and some forgo the columns, and instead use magnetic beads coated in either silica or the resin. Replacing some of the centrifuge steps with beads can really speed this up. That's why I was working on making some of my own. I actually just got the supplies to make more, so expect some tests of those soon. Now, let's compare to the spiders. I actually tried running a spider through the bacteria kit, and it failed as spectacularly as you might imagine. The reason is because the solutions are tuned to solve a different set of problems. First, lysozyme, the enzyme in the bacteria kit, only affects components of bacterial cell walls, so the much more robust spider cells and clumpy proteins were unaffected. On top of that, the spiders are full of natural inhibitors and other enzymes that are still active. So when you pop open any of the cells, they can wreak havoc and destroy any good DNA you manage to get out. So I picked up a special insect/arthropod kit which addresses all of this. It's a 27-step procedure, and some of these steps loop or have long incubation times. When I did this, I started at 5 p.m. and didn't finish until 11:30. Not time efficient by any means, but if it works, it works. First up, it only wanted 30 milligrams of tissue, which is about a third of a spider. This may not seem like a lot, but it'll give plenty of DNA to work with. I chose part of the dorsal side of the abdomen, as it's high enough to not touch the silk glands and make a mess, but also contains lots of soft tissue. This was suspended in CTL buffer, and I used a P1000 tip to grind the tissue and disperse it into the solution. In this kit, this is the lysis buffer, but instead of SDS as their soap, they use a cationic surfactant called CTAB. Then I added an enzyme called proteinase K. As a protease, its job is to break down proteins, and since spiders are chock full of them, it's got its work cut out for it. To speed things along, the tube was put into a heat block set to 60 degrees Celsius. This is the longest part of this process and can take anywhere from 30 minutes to 4 hours. Before putting it in, the solution was murky and opaque, but after 2 hours, it had fully cleared, which is the stopping point. To really clean things up, the kit says to add a 24:1 mixture of chloroform and isoamyl alcohol, neither of which come in the kit. So I made some chloroform and sourced the isoamyl. What this will do is collect any nonpolar debris, as well as twist proteins inside out and move them out of the aqueous layer. After giving everything a gentle mix, the tube is spun down and you end up with a layer of debris at the interface between the water and chloroform. I ended up making a stack of stuff so that I could get this at eye level to make it easier. Not great lab practice, but I wanted good results. The top aqueous layer is transferred to a fresh, sterile 1.5 milliliter tube for further processing, being careful not to disturb the debris. To our now clean solution, we add some RNase A and HBC buffer and incubate at 70 degrees Celsius for 10 minutes. This will destroy any RNA while also deactivating any proteins that stuck around. Then we add ethanol before loading it into the same sort of filter and tube setup as before. However, in this case, the kit says their filters are resin-based, not silica-based, which I thought was interesting. After spinning that down, it's onto a series of washes with the provided wash buffer. And finally, after all that, we can dry the column by spinning it empty for a few minutes, transfer it to a final collection tube, and elute our DNA, again letting it rehydrate for a few minutes beforehand. As you can see, it's still the same basic process, but because of the tough tissue sample, extra steps and ingredients were needed to get the best results. Speaking of the results, there are two ways to analyze your sample once the extraction is done. Run it on a gel, which we've discussed in two previous videos, or test it with a special spectrometer. Personally, I like using a gel better. Not only is it vastly cheaper, since we dye the DNA with a stain that really only sticks to DNA, it's much harder to get a false positive, which actually happened during an earlier spider extract. The spectrometer said we had hundreds of nanograms of DNA, but when we ran it on a gel, there was clearly no DNA present. This is because the spectrometer can easily be set off by protein or other chemical contaminants left over from the extraction. We've since run both samples on a gel, and we finally got lots of DNA out of the bacteria and spiders. We actually saw the bacterial result in the gel doc video. But there's a problem with the spiders. In theory, we're supposed to be isolating genomic DNA, which is huge strands of DNA. As we discussed in the gel electrophoresis video, this should look like a nice band near the top of the gel. But the spider DNA looks like a smear low on the gel, which means it's highly damaged, and most of what we isolated is shredded DNA fragments. This actually matches up with an earlier result where we managed to get a whiff of spider DNA, but at the time assumed it had just been damaged by the extraction protocol. Now the running hypothesis is that the ethanol preserves the spiders and prevents them from rotting, but it doesn't stop the spiders' native enzymes from destroying the DNA. And this kind of makes sense. When I cut into the spiders, they were mush on the inside, meaning everything was damaged. So now I'm looking to source fresher spiders. I've already got a few leads, so hopefully some of them will turn out. As a last resort, we may switch to another spider species because they're easier to get, but for now, I want to see if we can get the widows to work. At least now we know that this kit works, so as soon as we have a fresher specimen, we can definitely move forward. But other than that, those are all the basics of DNA extraction using columns. Depending on the style and exact kit, the amount of time it takes can vary, but it's never really a difficult process. It mostly involves planning in advance, getting the right tools, and following the recipe. Before we wrap up, this is actually a great moment to talk about the sponsor of this video, The Great Courses Plus. Many of you have been asking how to get started learning the basics of biology, and The Great Courses Plus is a good place to do that. It's a subscription on-demand video learning service with top-notch lectures and courses from Ivy League professors and experts from places like the Smithsonian and the Culinary Institute. Your subscription gives you unlimited access to over 11,000 courses on almost any topic you may be interested in, be it math, science, cooking, or anything else. Personally, I've really been enjoying Mysteries of the Microscopic World by Professor Bruce Fleury. It's a great deep dive into the history of microbiology and how microbes have shaped the world. The Great Courses Plus is giving my viewers a free trial, so show your support for the show by going to thegreatcoursesplus.com/thoughtemporium or click the link in the description to start your free trial today. To close out, I once again want to take a moment to talk about Nerd Thunder, which is an opportunity for science and maker channels to do some cross-promotion. This time, the channel I think you should check out is Nile Red. I know some of you already watch his videos, but he did a great video on extracting DNA with the shot glass method, though he used a whole 1-liter beaker. So be sure to check that out if you want to see how you can extract DNA without any fancy kits and using only stuff that you have lying around the house. And that's where I think I'll end this video. If you enjoyed, be sure to subscribe and ring the bell to see when I post new videos. While sponsors for videos are great, this channel is made possible largely because of my patrons and channel members, so if you'd like to help the research and keep the videos coming, consider supporting. That's all for now, and I'll see you next week.